From Benue State University, North Central Nigeria. I'd like to welcome the presenters, and then we agree, you do your presentation in 10, 15 minutes. And then after that, after all the presentation, we give the audience the opportunity to interact with you. The idea is we intend to have a very robust dialogue, and I keep insisting on that. The less you talk more, the better for us. Yeah. So please, at the end of 10 minutes, I'll give you a notice. You have 5 minutes. At the end of 15 minutes, I'll stop you as the chair of this panel. Thank you very much. So without much ado, let me welcome the first presenter.
All right, thank you very much for that introduction. In this paper, actually this presentation, what I'm really trying to understand is how we have constructed the modern African diaspora. And I'm taking my motivation really from an article that was written by a historian called Earl Lewis, who is looking at diaspora as overlapping, right? And he's trying to understand how we have written black people in particular into the African diaspora. And so I am borrowing from him in particular to understand how we have not written certain groups of people into the modern African diaspora. And I'm focusing specifically on African students. And I'll talk more about why this population. So when we talk about the modern African diaspora, it's oftentimes a post-1965 phenomenon that is framed by the 1965 law of immigration in the US, right? It's an immigrant diaspora for the most part, whether in popular culture or in scholarship. And it has a tension, I believe, between long-term settlement and also temporary sojourn. So that there's this underlying tension that we never really acknowledge, right? And I'm attempting to look at this. I argue that our picture of this diaspora is incomplete because it's post-1965. But as we define it in scholarship, it's framed much larger, right? It's framed from the late 19th century to the present moment. And this is framed by many scholars, including Paul Zeleza, Earl Lewis, and others, right? But we focus on this post-1965 immigration. We do this in large because we have very little evidence of the African immigrant presence prior to 1965. I agree that we don't have evidence, but I feel like that's not enough of an excuse to not address this. And so I am curious as to what that diaspora looked like for the pre-1965 diaspora. And I try and address this in this paper by looking at how U.S. immigration laws have shaped who has come to the U.S. In such strict ways, outlining who is an immigrant and a non-immigrant, and for the most part, African students, as other foreign students, are defined as non-immigrants. So just to give some context, if you look historically at immigration to the US from 1820 to 1961, Africa sent the fewest number of migrants, basically, to the United States during this period. It sent about 49,000 immigrants as compared to 1 million from Asia and more than 34 million from Europe. This is a stark disparity, right? When we talk about the brain drain in particular, we never talk about this historical context, right? For many of us, it's the simple issue is that Africans are taking their intellectual talents elsewhere, right? But we never attempt to quantify what that looks like. I think we have to begin to do so, because if you look at this picture, you see that Europe has benefited largely from U.S. immigration laws in particular. And so why African students, right? African students have one of the longest existing relationships with the United States, It's a process that goes as far back as 1774, when two Africans are sent to the College of New Jersey, which is now called Princeton University. These are John Kwame and Bristol Nyamu from the Gold Coast. They are sent to be trained as missionaries who would then be sent back to the African continent. This blueprint unfolds in the decades and centuries to follow. And African students are brought to the United States in the 19th century and onwards, really around sort of this key focus, right? We have some stories about the students who come in the 19th century in particular, right? And in the 20th century, even more prominently. So people like Nnamdi Azikiwe and Kwame Nkrumah, in the 20th century, we know those stories, right? There are other stories of people like James Agre, Simbini Nkomo, I know Rishatuke Faduma, which are less known but are still available to us. I also note that how we've defined the African diaspora is really tied to understanding the experiences of African students. And this comes through the work of George Shepperson, right, who is considered to be the father of the African diaspora, or I consider him to be father of African diaspora, as we term it, right? And Shepperson, in the late 1950s, is trying to explain the experiences of African students in the United States. He's looking in particular in this book that I mentioned here, of one John Chilembwe, who was brought to the US by a white. Excuse me. John Chilembwe is brought to the US in the early 19th century by a white missionary from South Africa named John Booth. Shepperson is trying to explain how Chilembwe is influenced in his time in the United States, so much so that he goes back home and leads a revolt, which ultimately fails, right? And so he comes up first with the term, which he terms all Africanism, to try and explain this, but he then moves on to diaspora as a better way to sort of explain these new world forces and how they're acting on African students, in particular in the United States. So I think this is one thing that we have yet to acknowledge in our framing of the modern African diaspora. So as a means to sort of explain why it is important that we write African students into the modern. I touched something. So the U.S. Naturalization Act of 1870 is an interesting law in that it allowed for white immigrants to become naturalized citizens of the United States, but it includes a very small passage which is of importance to African immigrants in particular, because it allows for persons of African descent to become naturalized citizens. This makes this group of people the only non-white immigrant group that can become U.S. citizens during this time. So Asians can't become citizens, Latinos, and Native Americans. And it's focused on alien Africans in particular, because the 14th Amendment already gave the citizen rights to former slaves and freed blacks in the United States. So it's specifically focused on this group. And so I look at the records from the U.S. Congress during this time and the Senate, who are debating this act, and looking at the actions of one senator in particular, who's Charles Sumner of Massachusetts, who introduces an amendment to the act, right? Because he wants the act to include non-whites as well. Thank you. And he uses as a part of his argument his focus on Africans in the country, right? He's referring to Africans in Florida, which at the time we have very few evidence. There's no evidence of this time that suggests that there were hundreds of Africans in Florida. I believe he's referring to Black Caribbeans in Florida at this time, but he calls them Africans anyway, right? His amendment is rejected because he's trying to use this group as a means to justify why we have to include non-whites, right? It's rejected, But another senator actually proposes that we give these rights to Africans who are alien to the U.S., right? And he does this in a tongue-in-cheek way, because at this time, the U.S. Senate was debating this law. There was a lot of concern about Chinese immigration to the United States. And so they juxtaposed African immigration against the Chinese, right? And they sort of argue that Africans represent a model immigrant, in quotes, and it's not really fleshed out, but this sort of comes out in the language in which they're using to describe Africans during this time period. But they're really focused on the fact that Chinese immigrants are not desired, right? Now, they understand that there are very small numbers of Africans in the United States from the continent, right? And so they don't really have the belief that people are going to take advantage of this law. And for the most part, they're proven right. So the amendment actually passes by one vote. So it's a very close vote, but it gives the right nevertheless for alien Africans to become naturalized citizens of the United States in 1870, right? At this time, there are about 2,600 African immigrants in the US, right? We have no direct way of understanding how people would use this law to become citizens, besides the numbers in which we see in the US Census Bureau. That's the only sort of direct way right now, at least as I have looked at it, in understanding how people will use this law. But we have some narratives of African students who become naturalized citizens, right? So these students came to the US for study and would eventually stay in the US after the completion of their degrees and would live in the US as US citizens. So people like James Agre and Ross Law are just some few examples of these individuals. So to give some context, the number of immigrants who have come to the US from Africa, in 1850, there were about 551 immigrants recorded. And I need to make a point of note here, that when we talk about immigration, there is an important way to understand this. So there's the documented immigrants who come to the United States, and then the undocumented immigrants as well, right? So the US Census Bureau has over the time had its issues with how it records immigrants, right? And this is important to understand in context here as well. So in 1850, there were 551 immigrants from Africa, and by 1900, there were about 2,500. By 1930, there are 8,859 immigrants. One thing to address here is that how the census records this immigration pattern, right, is important, because it also breaks it down by race, right? And so the 551 immigrants from Africa in 1850 also include white immigrants, right? So we have to be conscious of that as well. So in 1924, the Immigration Act of 1924 was passed, and this fixed for every country in the world a national quota, right? And it established this at 2% of the number of foreign-born of any nationality in the U.S. in 1890, right? So if there were 1,000 African immigrants in U.S. in 1890, we're talking about 20 African immigrants. Fortunately, the number was set at it was a minimum of 100 immigrants per country. But what it also did importantly was that it set a cap on the total number of people who could come to the U.S. for a given year. And it established, importantly, two big categories. One is the quota immigrant and the non-quota immigrant. Non-quota immigrants are important because they're a very well-defined population, which will include students, right? Africa, in particular, was limited in its immigration because the U.S. only recognized four sovereign countries during this time: South Africa, Liberia, Ethiopia, and Egypt. Africans who were coming from other regions of Africa had to come under the quota limitations of the colonizers, right? In 1930, there were about 9,000 foreign students in the U.S., this is an estimate, and most of them came from quota-restricted countries. And in fact, we see this as a pattern in the future, that many students from African countries in particular are coming under these quotas. I take that back. They're not coming under these quotas because they're non-quota students, right? So this is sort of a key way in being able to it's a key way to circumvent these laws that restrict who can come to the United States or who can't. But there are still some very strict requirements of these students. So they have to possess paperwork that would certify that they were being accepted in the U.S. to a higher education institution, had to pass interviews, and they had to provide evidence of their finances. Just to kind of give you a brief understanding of the number of students who are coming to the United States, these are the five major countries that are sending students to the United States during this period. It's from 1923 to 1950, Egypt, Ethiopia, Nigeria, South Africa, and Liberia. And as you see, in the 1920s, there are few students. But as the years go by, the numbers increase. This is a picture of this from 1960 to 2000, African students have always made up a larger percentage of their group as opposed to African immigrants. So African immigrants in the year 2000 were 3% of the foreign-born population in the U.S. as opposed to African students in 2000 at 5.5%. And I believe it's probably fairly even today. So things are changing. So some of the steps I think we can take in writing the African student into the modern African diaspora are to look more at oral histories. They're African students who have been in the U.S. for more than 40 years. They're former African students who have been in the U.S. for more than 40 years, and we have neglected their stories and their experiences and what they can tell us about the modern African diaspora. So we need more ethnographies, more oral histories. We need to look at archival records from the INS, the Census Bureau, and we need to analyze race, gender, and non-returning students. Thank you.
After this, I have a week of vacation and I did not bring a laptop, so no images here. What I will say is that this, the paper that I'm giving today will be the second chapter in a, I've got a contract, about a 10-year-old contract with Routledge to do a book on the African diaspora for Robin Cohen's Diaspora series, the first chapter of which has been actually online for about 12 years. It's called Defining the African Diaspora. It will need to be redefined a little bit, but this will be the second chapter. Kim Butler writes, quote, "To map a diaspora requires consideration of its internal dynamics in conjunction with spatiality in order to more accurately represent a transnational reality," end quote. In this paper, I begin by attempting to provide a global picture of the current population of Africans in the diaspora and the kinds of epistemological and philosophical questions such figures raise about how we go about the process of counting. I next briefly summarize the long history of the forced dispersion of African peoples. Without diminishing the central significance of the Atlantic slave trade for modern world history and for Africans, I want particularly to locate it in its broader perspective, both in time and space. This exercise will demonstrate that the diaspora neither began nor ended with the Atlantic slave trade, but that the Atlantic slave trade was unquestionably the most dramatic instance of forced migration in the history of the world. These issues serve to introduce the issue of the internal African diaspora, which I want to place in the wider context of the African diaspora, and I think this is probably what fewest of you might have thought about. Here I hope to make the point that there has been as much, if not more, forced movement by specific African peoples from one place to another within Africa as there has been beyond Africa, and with many of the same consequences and processes of adjustment as Africans faced among non-African societies in the diaspora. Turning to the colonial and post-colonial contexts, labor migration, brain drain, and refugees have all complicated this phenomenon. And we've heard a lot about these issues at this conference. Finally, I conclude with some comments on the free movement of Africans and their resettlement overseas from earliest times through the colonial era in Africa. And this fits right in with what our previous speaker was saying. Although the numbers were small, I believe it is important to appreciate that it was not only the slave trade that caused Africans to migrate, but that through their own agency, individuals and small communities also made such choices. These included such diverse categories as traders, sailors, mercenary soldiers, Ethiopian Coptic priests, and Muslim pilgrims. So there are four sections to the paper. First of all, locating Africans in the diaspora today, which I'll say something about. Then the forced global dispersion of African peoples, which I'm not going to say very much about because it's probably what most people know something about. And then the internal African diaspora. And then finally, free and uncoerced emigration from Africa. So locating Africans in the diaspora today. Today, communities of people of African descent inhabit much of the entire globe. In presenting this overview of the spatial dimensions of the African diaspora, I include major secondary migrations, such as the dispersal of different Caribbean peoples after emancipation to Central and Northern Europe, North America, and Europe. Part of virtually every modern nation and territory in the Americas has a population of African descent. In some cases, these are identified as being black, a designation which assumes, rightly or wrongly, that there has been little or no significant genetic mixing with the dominant Euro-American population. In others, these are revealed by the rubric of mulatto. So I begin this whole process by moving from north to south in the Americas. I'm not going to say anything particular about the United States or Canada because as I started doing this, one of the things, of course, that North American countries have got, and the United States, for better or for worse, has got the census model that every other country uses as a model. So there's a lot of counting, there's a lot of data. Racial data is included, and relatively speaking, it's reliable census data, and it also allows increasingly for open identification data, so people can identify themselves in one way or another, and that's true of Canada too. So I'll drop right to the Caribbean. In the Caribbean, people of African descent dominate the population of every island nation, the main exception being Trinidad and Tobago, where it's sort of 50-50. With respect to identity, however, it's important to recognize that Afro-Dominicans and Afro-Puerto Ricans, as well as many Afro-Cubans, generally identify themselves as Hispanic or Latino, rather than black or African, as a consequence of their histories of Spanish cultural and linguistic domination and the myth of racial democracy. DR is a good example of this. Haiti being the African side of the island and the Dominican Republic being not. Irrespective of how people choose to identify themselves, it is enough to regard these populations demographically as being of African descent, and therefore as indicators of the dispersal of Africans throughout the Americas as a consequence of the Atlantic slave trade. And you will recognize from last night's keynote that I'm doing sort of the first part of what our speaker talked about. Now, similar issues of identity that appear in the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico, similar issues of identity and official recognition extend to the rest of Latin America, where blacks have generally been ignored as a distinct group. This is partly a matter of government ignorance or oversight or just they didn't care, but also people's reluctance to be identified as African. So if you compare the figures from individual countries that do collect racial data, you can see how politicized the whole process of representation or suppression of the process of counting can become. Brazil is one of the few countries, Latin American countries, that seeks information about racial identity. And of course, Brazil's an odd place because even people who aren't of African descent want to claim it in some way. It's in some cases, it's a very, very different thing. But until 2000, outside of Brazil, only Colombia and Nicaragua collect data on ethnicity in this sense. Now, Bolivia, Costa Rica, Ecuador have done so, but it's very politicized. And I think everybody knows how, for years, Argentina, for example, said there are no black people at all in Argentina. It turns out, of course, there were quite a few Africans in Argentina, particularly in Buenos Aires in the 19th century. Tango is sort of has certain African roots. There's these, so it's very complicated once you get into Latin America. So whatever the place of Africanity or lack thereof in Latin America, as well as the ability or willingness of governments to enumerate them accurately, this broad region is clearly home to millions of people who carry some element of African heritage in their persons. And I should say right away that I'm not attempting even a guesstimate of numbers at this point. I'm talking in really gross figures because I think it's important to get that out there. So leaving the Americas, turn to Europe. And it's not possible to get a total for Europe as a whole, but the figures for the UK, France, and Portugal alone add up to something like 1.6 million people, which suggests that the total for Europe as a whole may be at least 2 million, especially considering how many new migrants are coming in. But France presents some very specific problems, which are reminiscent of some of the issues in Latin America, but are specific to France, which is that if you're a French citizen, you're a French citizen. You're nothing else. And so the Africans who are counted in France are other Africans, and they also include North Africans. They're not black French citizens. So all the black French footballers aren't counted in that census. So there's, and this extends to overseas, the overseas department. So, you know, Martinique and Guadeloupe are French. They're not identified as being black French in that sense. So that's a peculiarity, and it's an example of one of the problems of different systems of counting. When we turn to the Islamic Mediterranean, the Indian Ocean world, the challenge of calculating is much different because, of course, the censuses aren't as good, the numbers of people is just harder to figure out. Also, the universalism of Islam sort of makes this a difficult thing to get at. There are certainly, when you get there, but there's lots of people of African descent in Arabia. And the whole Arabian Peninsula. There's Afro-Iranians, there's Shidis in Pakistan, there's Sidis in India. These are small populations, but certainly in Arabia, these are large populations. The Mascarene Islands raise this kind of Caribbean problem all over again. Réunion is French, so they don't count people by ethnicity. And in Mauritius, it's a classic case. In Mauritius, at the beginning of the 19th century, about 80% of the population was Afro-Malagasy. And then when slavery was ended and Asians, South Asians were brought in as indentured servants, within 40 years the population was two-thirds South Asian. Afro-Malagasys were then called Creoles, which, you know, there are many different meanings to Creole, but were called Creoles. And then as the census went along, they became part of what's called general population, which includes the handful of whites, white Mauritians left. So basically, people of Afro-Malagasy descent have been erased from the record. You just have to know what the longer history is to count them. So the range of population data is very wide, but you can see that there are smaller, much smaller populations elsewhere in the Indian Ocean world. So I'm not going to talk about the slave trade because we can come back to that if you want. What I do want to say is something about the internal African diaspora. A number of scholars have pointed out, have suggested, since we certainly have no numbers, clearly, that the numbers may have equaled the total export trade from Africa. And I think the consequences for individuals, leaving aside the problems of Euro-American racism in the Atlantic world, were not so dissimilar because people were uprooted from their homes and had to learn new customs and were generally stigmatized where they were. There's two aspects to this. There is an oceanic trade, a transoceanic trade to the African islands. So to Zanzibar, Madagascar, Comoros. So there's people from Mozambique who were sent to Madagascar as slaves, just as there was people who were enslaved in Madagascar and sent out to the Mascarene Islands. But the Cabo Verde Islands, Sao Tome and Principe, the presence of so-called Angolares there, Cape Town, which has both Mozambican and Malagasy descendants, so-called Zanzibaris in Durban, and then the Creole population in Sierra Leone. And then there are also peoples from East Central Africa who were enslaved to Southern Somalia, some of whom actually been repatriated to Tanzania and a couple to Mozambique. But in addition to all of those people, there's an internal trade, and this becomes much, much more significant in the 19th century as the export slave trade begins to be shut off, particularly in the Atlantic world. And their process is, the process of adjustment is very much the same. Marty Klein has suggested for West Africa that maybe one third of these folks tried to, especially if they were born free, to return to their original homes or move elsewhere. But most of those peoples who were the descendant of slave enslaved populations in Africa had stayed. And there's a number, there's a lot of evidence, some very good studies of Ghana by Peter Hanegar, by Sandra Green, that talk about the stigmatization. Everybody knows who is of slave origin, and it counts against you. Marty Klein has written about this in people not wanting to recognize this or to talk about it in the Western Sudan, even though where everybody knew about it. And then the same is true of Yves-Trop Powell has written about Sudanese in Egypt. Shuki El-Hamel has written about the Ganawa and black Moroccans and the problem there. And I know from my own field experience in Tanzania doing an interview in Kaole, which is just south of Bagamoyo, I was talking about the slave trade with the elders in Kaole, and somebody from the back spoke up and said something. They told him to shut up. Well, it turned out his mother was Manyema, that she was of slave descent. She wasn't central, and so you shouldn't have been talking to him. So these things show up in lots of ways. And this isn't, you know, this is not a way of trying to, you know, adjust the export trade, but these are serious problems of adjustment within Africa. The final thing to say here before I just read my brief conclusion is that there was free and uncoerced migration from Africa. So there were Nubian diplomats and merchants in ancient Egypt. There were Ethiopian monks in eastern Mediterranean, particularly in Jerusalem. If any of you have been to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem, you will see, you know, their modern equivalents, and also from the church that Menelik had built in 1898, I think it was, in Jerusalem. There were Christian Ethiopian merchants and craftsmen in pre-Islamic Arabia. And there were Muslim Ethiopian Jabarti traders in Aden and Yemen, and free sailors. And So my time is up. The one thing I would say is that that Hajis, that there are so-called takrur in Saudi Arabia, and also so-called falata in the Sudan, over 1 million, who were people who were on the Hajj, so freely going on the Hajj, but didn't have the scratch to get back home. So and they've been left there. So if you look at the whole, diaspora, it's a very complex process that involves what went on within Africa, and it's clear that most people were forced to leave Africa or to move, were taken from their homeland within Africa and moved to somewhere else. But there were also these interesting examples of people who chose to move on their own. So I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
So this paper started off as as the fifth chapter to my dissertation, which I'm about to finish up in June. And thank you. That's a little bit of a premature clap there, because I have not finished yet. But anyway, let me just dig into it and try to rush through it in 15 minutes. It's 40 pages long, so I'm going to try to just burst right through it, okay? So in much of the United States, black men are stereotyped as thugs, and black women as welfare queens. Now, the impetus behind such disagreeable labeling has genealogical ties to slavery. Prior to being subjected to this malevolent form of servitude, blacks were scarcely thought to be different than whites. Now, it's clear that people of African descent are phenotypically dissimilar from Europeans because of their sable skin and woolly hair. But these dissimilarities did not stop them from eating, sleeping, socializing, even running away together under the harsh and oppressive conditions of New World bondage. Neither did differences in skin color stop black and white indentured servants and slaves from taking up arms together, which they did during Bacon's Rebellion, where they joined forces in Virginia in 1676 in order to challenge the economic hegemony of the planter class. Now, the members of the planter class were stunned by this black-white alliance and developed a potent strategy to neutralize it. using balkanization techniques, they supplanted this multiracial populist movement with a bribe. As long as whites promised to keep their sable fellows in check, they would be granted an honorific status above them, and would be regarded as wage earners instead of slaves. As a result, and as with the wave of a wand, whites were placed in a higher social category than that of their dispossessed black brethren. So it was asserted that black skin and woolly hair were devilish marks revealing a natural taint. And I want to suggest that this pernicious lie, cooked up for the sake of justifying the institution of slavery and for separating the mutual economic interest of black and white laborers, began to stand on its own legs and persist today in the myth of the black criminal and in the form of the institution of mass incarceration. And I'll show how this is linked to the concept of black women as welfare queens a little bit later. So in an article entitled From Slavery to Mass Incarceration, Rethinking Race in the U.S., the noted sociologist and ethnographer Loic Wacquant argues that America's first three institutions, peculiar institutions, slavery, Jim Crow, and the ghetto have this in common. They were each designed with the intent of exploiting black labor and for creating an almost impenetrable form of social cleavage. Now, my aim is to follow this argument and to show how each of these forms of domination and oppression have morphed into a fourth peculiar institution called mass incarceration. And due to time constraints, I can't elaborate as fully as I would like to, so I'm just going to do the best I can and try to drive through it again. So slavery in the Americas can most simply be described as an agrarian-based economic institution that exploited an unfree black labor base and that developed a rigid racial caste system. And the Jim Crow, which directly followed that, wasn't much different. It was a stern set of bigoted laws and cultural norms established for the purpose of continuing the exploitation of black labor through sharecropping and through reinforcing the practice of relegating blacks to a permanent second-class status. So, tired of the ill treatment and social debasement that they were suffering at the hands of hostile whites under Jim Crow, many Southern blacks became enamored with the idea of heading north, which for them represented something akin to the biblical promised land. But when they got to the north, they found themselves herded into slums and ghettos by means of comprehensive communal white violence. And it was there that they had begun to realize that the black ghetto was again, like slavery and Jim Crow, a device for caste control, a mechanism designed for quarantining their alterity while exploiting them for their menial labor. But this mechanism of marginalization and exploitation, ghettoization is what I'm talking about, right? As effective as it was, is now becoming increasingly ineffective at managing the growing horde of urban poor persons created by America's new post-Fordist Keynesian economic and cultural vision. The emerging consensus on both the left and the right end of the American political spectrum on how to deal with this problem seems to be through the upsizing of the penal sector of the state. Hence, we appear to be in the middle of a transitional period where the institution of ghettoization is permutating into the institution of mass incarceration. Now, I want to suggest that it's imperative for black social critics, black leaders, and black intellectuals to understand how this complex system of mass incarceration stifles positive black self-understandings and self-images, it thwarts black self-determination, and it foils black self-development. Because the tag criminal may be different than the tag slave or sharecropper or menial laborer, the deleterious effects of it are just the same. Labeled as criminals, many blacks exist in a degraded and dishonored second-class status, lacking voting rights, the ability to engage in substantive and satisfying work, and are regarded as dishonorable, irredeemable citizens. So the most profound effect, though, of mass incarceration is that many black men have begun to internalize this criminal image and to view themselves and identify themselves as have their oppressors as essentially criminals and thugs. So through the negative evaluation of honor, many black men are attempting in vain, I want to say, to flip the script on criminality through the wholesale co-optation of the criminal image. It's a logic that says, well, if you're going to be perceived as a criminal, you may as well be the best damn criminal you can be. And the tragedy, though, is that such self-imagery is deprecating. And I want to expose how deprecating it is by means of talking about Tupac Shakur and how he talks about how the black ghetto youth, they want to be thugs. Like in one of his songs off his album, All Eyes on Me, Tupac says, he say he want to be, he say he going to be. He say he want to be short, he want to be a thug. So the sad thing, though, is many black boys have ambitions to become thugs and hoodlums. Because, as the popular rapper 2 Chainz candidly exhorts, the dope man is my Emma effing role model. Not Tiger, not Jordan, not Charles Barkley. Okay? So the respect for the dope man is grounded in the outlaw's ability to carve out an opulent living for himself in the midst of extremely harsh and impossibly cruel economic conditions. However, no matter how we try to spin thug imagery and lore, the tragic fact remains that no sublimation of a negative mark will result in a positive and healthy self-conception. So if it's egregious to characterize African-American men as criminals, well then how should they be depicted? Or to put it differently, how should others regard them and how should they regard themselves? Now, answering this question requires some insight into how African-American women ought to be perceived, so I'm gonna hold off answering it until I get there, okay? Now, I'm just gonna jump right into that. I got 5 minutes? That's no time, man. Okay, so in the early 1940s, the members of the National Resources Planning Board, the NRPB for short, and the National Resources Planning Board was a government organization created during the Great Depression in order to carry out FDR's, Franklin Delano Roosevelt's New Deal policies, right? The members of this board were intent on developing a comprehensive program for post-war economic growth and security. Their policy initiatives would culminate in the development of 2 bills, the Wagner-Murray-Dingell bills of 1943 and 1945, which would never see the floor of Congress. Now, with these bills, the NRPB members and other New Deal advocates were seeking to frame welfare as a broad form of public insurance designed to mitigate a vast constellation of social, structural, and economic problems. However, the position of fiscal conservatives in Congress, lack of support from labor unions, and an increase in middle class entitlements for white World War II veterans signaled doom for any chance of these bills' passage. If comprehensive initially signaled the effort to guarantee insurance for all Americans, it underwent a radical change of meaning after the Murray-Dingell bills of 43 and 45 failed. Instead of comprehensive entailing the expansion of those deemed worthy of receiving welfare or public insurance, it increasingly came to be understood as the expansion of therapeutic social services provided to problematic women. Thus, in place of characterizing all poor persons as victims of inegalitarian economic arrangements, social injustice, or unfortunate circumstances, the poor became feminized and stigmatized. That is, overwhelmingly the poor, especially poor urban mothers enrolled in programs like aid to dependent children's programs, they came to be regarded as troubled women in need of professional social services. Now, it's interesting because the ADC, it had its inception in the continuation of mothers' pensions programs that started in the early 20th century. And most of the recipients of aid from these programs were white widows. But over time, the program permutated into one in which the clientele increasingly changed to non-white mothers. So when the ABC's clientele was comprised of white widows, it was cool. It didn't come under public fire. However, as its clientele changed, it became scrutinized. And the problem was then how to justify income grants to poor unwed mothers, particularly black mothers, when most of the public harbored hostile racial prejudices towards black people in general. So in the early 1960s, there was this Louisiana governor named Jimmy Davis, and there was a Newburgh, New York City manager named Joseph Mitchell, and they waged war against the ABC. The former, Jimmy Davis, by dropping tens of thousands of poor unwed mothers from public assistance roles for having unsuitable households. The latter, by framing public assistance as an unfair redistributive system that burdens taxpayers by rewarding lazy chiselers and loafers. These powerful objections to black women receiving public assistance were responsible for bolstering and etching into the public American consciousness the image of the black welfare queen. So now I have to do the impossible in 1 minute or so, right? how to develop a positive imagery for black persons? There have been many people who've tried to do it, Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois, Malefe Kete Asante. But what I want to say is that Booker T. Washington and W.E.B. Du Bois, they have appropriated white conceptions of masculinity and manliness, and by doing so, they adopt the wrong path. You're not going to get much real estate out of developing a positive self-conception for yourself that is initially created in opposition to who you are as a person. So scratch that. And then I talk about Malefe Kete Asante and his idea of Afrocentricity, and I find nothing wrong with it, but there is something wrong with it to the extent that he wants us to adopt this romantic ideal of Africanness. That I'm an African American, first wave African diaspora. Consciousness has been cut off from Mother Africa. We've been deracinated. But I figured that, like, you just can't tell us, but we have to start following the ritual and cultural practices of Africa. Then all of a sudden we'll be healed, all the problems will be solved, our cultural memory will be restored, our psychological problems will be handled. No, we have to have honest, sincere dialogue with one another in order to create the bond and begin to repatch together what's been destroyed by this horrible and negative thing called the African diaspora. And that's it.
I also have a question for you. I came in a little bit late, so I apologize if you talked about this, but in terms of documenting the experience, lived experiences of African diaspora, international students, particularly in the university setting, I'm just wondering if you've looked at all into sort of like the culture of African student unions on college campuses, because those, in my experience and exposures to them, tend to be really rich sources of, you know, like collaborations and intercontinental dialogues.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. I want to, as a writer, to what the first person spoke concerning the newspaper, the journalism, So, I want to maybe try to help you a little and also challenge you in a manner that you could have your paper more enriched. I want to react to his comments that the period you actually studied, to me as a woman, I don't know if I'm being sentimental, could be the period where we women were still under the serious oppression and oppression of African men. She must be at home. The husband can go abroad to marry a white woman. And if you decide to come back or not, that would be the reason. But then you will further reach your paper if you could look for data in that area. And when you now get the data, I want to suggest that you try to make a part of your suggestions for improvement on this migration issue, the area of women being more active in, you know, migrating like the men. So that the oppression thing is being reduced, but then we can reduce it more and more. Thank you.
Yeah.
This is about your paper. I was wondering, you know, I came in a little late either, so I didn't really hear everything. But I was wondering if you considered, like, the notion when these predominantly white institutions were trying to admit black students, they were looking for Africans and not black students that were in America that were slaves or not
in,
or free blacks in America. So did you, like, consider that notion as well?
One question for the whole thing should be directed to my friend. So, you're asking any of these two, or maybe we'll reserve yours. Yes?
Actually, I think myself for the students. Questions about the students.
Right, just go on.
Okay, good. So I have a question about, I guess, your what you think is going to happen in the future. I'm from Michigan State, and I don't know if everyone's aware of the MasterCard scholarships that are trying to recruit younger pre-secondary and then undergraduate students African students from the continent to America and trying to socialize in an American way so that by the time they get to doctoral research and beyond, they don't have the same kind of appreciation, or they are actually trying to change what they understand about themselves to influence their later research as PhD scholars. Mm-hmm. So how do you think that's going to shape how we understand ourselves in the diaspora, how we understand African students in the diaspora?
Yeah.
I still had one question for each of the panelists. Ned, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the idea of mapping. You did mention, obviously, lots of global movements, but how you see that really very practically relating to mapping diaspora, just so to kind of add to, it seems like you ran out of time, so just to elaborate a little bit on that. And then for the last presentation, sorry I didn't catch your name, I was wondering if you could, if you had considered some of the work in feminist geography, sort of more recent work that, like, Ruth Wilson Gilmore was talking about prisons, or Catherine McKittrick, who's looking at the relationship between, like, the plantation as a space that kind of leads into the prison industrial complex. And that is both a space that is obviously incredibly fraught and determining in a bad way, but also possibly the space of optimistic things, I guess you could say. So the plantation leading to the prison could be possibly a space of hope. And I wonder if you could answer that.
We'll give them 10 minutes to respond, and then we'll take the next round of questions. Let's start with you.
Yes. So the question about women and where they are in this history, I think, is a very important one. Unfortunately, from what I've read, there aren't too many narratives or stories of women that are being written and published. Now, I'm not sure if it's because of the gender of the scholars who are looking at them, but I'm focusing solely on males. But I think there is something to be said that women in general are not coming to the U.S. during this period in large numbers. The only woman I can think of is from South Africa, and her name is Charlotte Manier, who comes to the U.S. as a part of a singing group. It's called the Jubilee Group. And she comes in 1896, and I believe goes to Wilberforce University, right? And she goes there with her husband. So that speaks to this question about women's ability to move, basically, and to migrate as being controlled in some part by men. So there is a significant gap there that has not been addressed yet, and that has to be addressed. So the question of on Black Americans and if they were purposely not chosen for I'm sorry, I think I wrote the question perhaps the wrong way. So if you could repeat it for me, I would greatly appreciate it.
I was asking that when these institutions were trying to integrate someone, this was in the 1800s, this is like institutions like Harvard or Cornell, the first Black students, they were not Black, they were African.
Right.
So I was trying to see what was the significance and if you thought of that in your work.
Right. It's a great question. So they're not making a significant distinction, at least in the beginning. So one example is Lincoln University, right, which is foremost in helping to educate Africans as missionaries, right? Lincoln records show that the missionaries that they're sending to Africa, who are Black Americans, are dying because of illnesses, right? And so there's a concern that maybe these individuals are not able to tolerate the climates of Africa, which I think is an unfounded concern per se, but this is what is coming out in some of the records of the trustees who are writing about the need to bring African students to the U.S. to be trained as missionaries, right? Mm-hmm. But there's still an effort, right, at Lincoln and Fisk and other institutions to train Black Americans who would then go back to the continent and help spread the seeds of Christianity. So the examples of Black missionaries who are trained, who do go back to the continent and who do work on the continent as well. So I don't know that there's a explicit emphasis per se, but I think there is an underlying philosophy, you could say, about that. as to what's going to happen in the future. I'm really intrigued by Michigan State University, I believe, and the scholarship that you're talking about. It sounds very sort of pernicious, conspiracy related, I don't know. Right, controversial. And I think this really speaks to this issue of the model minority, right? So this notion that we have that Africans somewhat represent a better black, right, in the US, and how policy now is really starting to use that language. I think that's very troubling. There was an article written recently about a young Ghanaian immigrant who got admitted to all 8 Ivy League schools, right? Mm-hmm. And sort of the language in which they use to describe his accomplishment is very, very coded, I would say. So it celebrates his parents, who are both nurses, right? And how hard they must have worked to help him achieve this accomplishment. And in an offhanded kind of way, suggests that this cultural capital, right, is responsible for his success. And there's so many issues with race and in that. So I'm concerned that it's only going to get worse. Oh, sorry.
I have a question.
Yeah, she had a question.
Oh, yeah, right.
African student unions, yes. I forgot to mention that. So there is significant evidence of African student unions in the United States, starting, in fact, with the ASA, which was founded by Nkrumah and others in the late 1930s, right? The other organizations that would evolve from this, one is, it's called the Pan-African Student Union of the Americas, which is PASOWA, which sort of comes to being in the late 1950s and 60s, and takes on this radical approach. I forgot the name of one of the leaders of the organization was an individual from Rhodesia at the time who disappears, and the argument is that he was kidnapped in part by the CIA because he was speaking out loud about the activities of the CIA in Africa. So there are these organizations out there, and I am beginning to look at some of their papers.
It's okay, thanks.
Thank you for the question about the idea of mapping. One of the interesting things is that one of the reasons I think I probably started this particular chapter is that for the most part there isn't, you know, there aren't these kinds of attempts. There is a map which you can find online if you Google African diaspora map. It's something that was put together for Joe Harris by the cartography department at Cornell in 1990, but it's basically hardly any different from maps of the Atlantic slave trade with some of the Indian Ocean stuff. So I was kind of curious, and one of the reasons I haven't yet gotten around to actually doing it or telling the publisher that I'm going to want to do maps is because they'll say how many. But I think this is one of these examples. We've talked about this in one of the other panels about place and time. So I think that you need to do these maps. Since I'm a historian and I'm not trying to, you know, I'm not trying to collapse it all into one, that looking at doing these things, and I'm not even quite certain, maybe a pre this and then post that, that it will be important to get place and time put together. The only person who's attempted this, there are 3 maps at the front, and they're unfortunately unpaginated, so you don't quite know how to cite them, but there are 3 maps at the front of George Reed Andrews' book on Afro-Latin America. And he has it, and I think one of the things is to it's nice about it. It sort of has it shaded into, at, you know, 1850, let's say 1900, 2000, something like that. That these areas had recognizable or a certain percentage, you know, higher than this, lower than that, percentage of people of African descent. So one of the other problems is, and I think I'd rather do, there probably could be different kinds of maps, some which are directional and some which are sort of more population based at certain times. But for example, a good example would be, let's say Portugal. I'm not going to just do a map, but if you take Portugal in the 15th and 16th century, it's going to have a much higher Afro-descended population than it does in the 18th century or the 19th century. It's only since the revolution of the Carnations and the liberation of the African colonies that it once again has an African population. There's an area in Lisbon called Rua Poços dos Negros, Posu is a well or a, it has all kinds of meaning. And when I first was working in Lisbon in the 1960s, there were no Negros there. The last time I was there, which not, you would walk down and everybody's speaking Criollo. They're not speaking Portuguese. It was a, it had become a couple, so there, things change over time, and I think that's why with maps, you know, there's something to be said for not putting too many of these kinds of maps in a book, and maybe having a kind of, you know, an E. Gutenberg version where you can have endless maps online that are connected to the text so that you can see how these things change over time. But I think space and time together are the two key elements. Thank you very much.
Yes, I too did not understand adequately the question that you were asking. I said something about feminist geography, and I'm not quite sure what that is.
There's been certain scholars have made a link, a spatial link between like the space of the plantation as leading into the space of the prison industrial complex, mass incarceration. And mostly that's been a negative. The criticism has been that obviously that's a negative segue, right, from the plantation.
I think so.
Right. Except that also, like, I'm citing like Catherine McKittrick here, who says there were, at the same time on the plantation, that obviously all sorts of atrocities happened, there were also moments where people resisted, where people made connections with one another. And if this is the space that is determining the kind of the present, like if the plantation sort of determines the American present and possibly the future, we have to look for both, like her argument is we have to look for not just the atrocities in that space. We have to find those moments of connection both in the past but also in places like the prison. Is a prison a place where kinship is kind of established, where communities are established, where people kind of push back against the idea of the thug? So that's what I was kind of asking. And I only suggested that because many of the people mentioned at the end, I mean, they were all men, but also there is a kind of scholarship of feminists. They're feminist geographers who are working on this idea. So maybe just to respond to that possibility.
That's pretty interesting. Yeah, I don't, you know, I'm not familiar with that research, but I can tell you I have a phenomenological experience with being in prison because I'm a convicted felon, so I've been there. And what I can tell you from my experience is that, a person who's been to prison is just like a person who's a person on the street. We're no different. I mean, we had the same hates, loves, joys, pains. I mean, but when you're in prison, it all depends on what kind of prison you're in and what type of environment you're in. Right now, I keep referring to Loic Laquant because he's somebody that I've studied. I've also studied Angela Davis. I've also looked at the work of Michel Foucault in relation to the functionality and what the prison is, what function it serves in society. But more referring back to Loic Laquant, the prison for a lot of people is a violent place where there's contraband drug wars taking place and men are fighting and killing each other over that space. So if there's no space for love there. It's not a space for let's find a means by which to look at the prison guards and the system and the state as an antagonistic target, right? They're targeting each other. They're consuming each other. And the system is perpetuated. The only way that perhaps even possibly you can get these people who are incarcerated in these prisons to become aware is to go into the prisons and to educate them about what's happening to them. To let them know what this process is. It's a process for quarantining alterity, for managing unwanted bodies, to managing your abject. And so I'll take a look at what you have to say.
Go ahead.
Add one quote.
This has
got to be the world's smallest hand
microphone. Actually, something that could relate to that, but not to say that it leads directly in, but in terms of confined space, is the Middle Passage and ships. And there is one of the things we know about the experience of Africans in the Middle Passage is that shipmates, Malungu in the Brazilian context, Sipis in the Dutch Caribbean, formed kin-like relations so that when people, they talk about splitting up families, but also people then would reconnect because they knew somebody, not because they were kin or even necessarily ethnically related, but they'd been on the same and survived the same horrors of that particular middle passage. And so there's, so, you know, and what comes out of that is not necessarily, I'm not trying to say that it's like prisons, but I think there's more spaces than just plantations to that. And in some cases, and this is where African agency obviously becomes so important, that people create, I mean, they're stuck in, how do we get here? Who is this person? This person is now my brother or sister because we were on the same ship together. And then sometimes that goes, there's some evidence that that's passed down at least one generation. People knew that their parents had been shipmates.
Yeah. I know it's time to go. No, if it's time to go, it's time to go. Now, I mean,
the next round of questions. Just 1 minute.
One minute. Very short.
Yeah, I mean, very short.
In terms of connectivity of people after prisons, it's discouraged.
Yeah.
Hey, you get out of jail. I knew you were here. I'm doing my time. And here is the time we're doing. Out there, I don't want to see you. I don't want to talk to you. I don't know you. I knew you. I don't know you now. And that's just kind of like the ethics of doing time.
You're not supposed to, right?
Right. I mean,
your parole officer doesn't want you to associate with
that. You can't. Personally, I mean, I find it hard to even manage my life under those rules because where I come from, damn near half the population, they're felons. Yeah. So if everybody's a felon, how can you not associate with a felon? Yeah. You know, it's just impossible to do. It's just empirically impossible to do. So, but in terms of reconnecting with people, It's difficult to do, and there's an ethics against it, you know, norms against it. So.
All right, we'll take the next round. Yeah, you were going to ask a question.
Yes. Hi, thank you everyone for your papers. My name is Seppo Sango-Sherry. I'm here at UT. And I have questions for everyone, but I will restrain myself. So, But my orientation is South Africa, as I said, and so I have a question for Dr. Alpers. Mm-hmm. And I work on what the South African state called colored identity, and so I'm very much interested in some of these port cities that you named as spaces for an expansive notion of Africanness and diasporic mapping in these port cities. And so I wondered, because the South African state in particular attempted to collapse notions of ethnic diversity in terms of the term colored itself, I wondered how you are getting this these long histories and evidence of cultural diversity among kind of the Mozambicans, who also became colored in some spaces, the Malagasy, and if they are maintained and circulated in sort of clandestine archives. That I see as sort of embodied archives, that people have these sort of oral histories that they carry around. My second question is for soon-to-be Dr. Bazil. And I'm wondering about the legibility of thug life and, well, you're saying welfare queens. In my case, I would actually say grant queens in South Africa, right? So what does this legibility of thug life and welfare queens look like outside of the U.S., and how is the engagement among people in the diaspora who are facing very similar sets of contemporary stereotypes?
My question is also about your presentation on Thugs and Welfare Queens, and it made me think of more recent, in some cases, changes that have been going on in Black society in the United States. For instance, gang cultures in Chicago that are publicly known for providing like public services, and I mean this goes back to even like Black Panther Party, typically criminalized Black groups that are predominantly, in most cases, male, that are empowering their communities at the same time that they're committing crimes and still criminalized bodies, things like that. And also, there was a study released last year that Black women are now seen through like banks as equally viable and attractive loan recipients as white males. And I think that says a lot about the cultural ways in which we view Black women's responsibility. So when at the end of your paper you were saying you were calling for us to sort of like reimagine blackness in the United States and to put forth these more positive images to challenge these stereotypes, my question is, how can we reimagine ourselves as black bodies, as black African Americans, keeping in mind this sort of not only the dichotomies of these stereotypes or realities, but also like the space in the middle, in order to keep it from being such a polarized view, which is also damaging and really problematic.
More questions?
Yes,
you want to ask? Let him ask, and then we'll see.
Okay.
I'd like to, go back to the relationship because I mean it's interesting. Yeah. With the time I think about the, I remember very well when we were growing up, they was the Cold War encouragement, the Russian Polish scholarship then, and the East Bloc, I mean, Eastern Bloc. I want to learn more about this. As of students, that's where what became of them, and what kind of role do we, I mean, there are just specific things that, I mean, we can learn under this kind of topic, considering the Eastern Bloc friendship and Diaspora.
Yeah.
Okay, the, well, actually, there's actually been quite, there's quite a good literature on the slave trade to South Africa. So people like Nigel Worden, Rob Shell, Patrick Harris, Wayne Dooling, Jim Armstrong, John Mason have all written about both the trade from Southeast Africa and the trade from Madagascar. There, for example, there's a group called Mozbeekers. And so there are specific things that, you know, where, and of course in South Africa, because people were being forced into working, if not always enslaved in the South Africa, you know, right within the Cape Colony. So we know the numbers quite accurately there, and so that's not. And of course, then there's the other peculiar thing, you know, that happens in the colored community, the Cape Malays, who. Some of whom were Malays, not all of whom were, you know. So there's that whole thing. And somebody like Kerry Ward in her Network of Empire has written, and Nigel Worden, too, takes you very much out into the Indian Ocean. So I think there's plenty of, those archives may have been hidden at one time, but the South Africanists have been plowing those fields pretty thoroughly. And there's also a book, and I can't remember the name of the author, but there's a book by a black South African writer woman who talks about memories of slavery. Yeah, that's right, yeah. And I've, one of these things I've got on my shelf that I have to look at more carefully. The interesting, the peculiar one, which I have found most peculiar, are the so-called Zanzibaris in Durban. And what they are, this is wonderful how names get put on people. These, when the British anti-slave trade patrols would capture, you know, Arab slavers or Swahili slavers, and liberate, because at this point, you know, you're being liberated, you're just going, you're not being sent home, where you were some way or other rooted out of, you're going from one form of captivity to another form where you don't have very much choice at all. But one of the places they finally took, towards the end, they took people down to Durban. And I think what happened, and there's a little bit of a literature about this, that what happened is this group got there, and remember that this, you know, it's not the Afrikaners who came up with the first set of really nasty racial legislation, it's the British in Natal who did. So as the sugar plantations were developing, I think that these liberated Africans, most of whom were clearly not Zanzibaris, they maybe were intended to go to Zanzibar, or maybe some of them had, you know, become Muslim a little bit, they must have looked around and said, well, I'm not white, and I'm not Indians who are just coming in, and I'm not Zulu, I'm not a Kaffir, so let me find something that fits. And what happened is they were partly taken in by the Muslim Indian community, which was quite small then, but took them in, and now what's in the last, I think about 10 years ago, they actually managed to reclaim land from the south, from the Durban, you know, from the Natal province, KwaZulu Natal, and they now have an area of land which has been returned to them as a community. So it's a process which I still don't, I'm not sure that any, there's been a couple of MA theses in South Africa, but I don't think people have understood yet completely what the process was by which they transformed themselves into, you know, liberated Africans.
Thank you very much.
So
you're next,
okay. Okay. 3 minutes to round up. Man, I keep wanting to pass the mic to somebody else. You were talking about how in America there's this conception of black women as welfare queens, but elsewhere this kind of imagery is being transplanted to other places, right?
I was just wondering if you had looked into it. I mean, for me, what popped up in the South African context is, there is this notion, this transportable notion from the West about thug life, but I would imagine, at least in the South African context, it would be grant queens, because there is a high sort of emergence of young black women who are getting Mandela grants, who are being, I mean, I'm just coining it, riffing off of what you're saying,
right.
They would be grant, you know, grant queens.
But I mean, do they actually call people grant queens in South Africa?
Grant queens.
No, I'm just saying, I mean, does that happen there, though?
I think we can talk about it a bit later, but I mean, when I was thinking about it, I mean, there's an issue of translation and language here, right, that occurs, and they wouldn't use the word grant queens, but they do use, so some people, especially I've heard older people who try to say it nicely and delicately, but also there's kind of this sinister kind of critique of young people, right, and they call them like Mandela's children, if I were to translate it in English. And then there are other people who berate them and basically, you know, you would say, I'm a grant. Like, so it's like the grant people. So I was just wondering if you had sort of seen this back and forth, part of which I think is communicated by music that you were suggesting.
Right. Well, you know, the problem with America is that, you know, American culture is ubiquitous because we have the largest media complex in the world. So whatever images are depicted and captured by Hollywood or the music industry or whatever the case may be, it gets transplanted to these other cultures. And then, of course, human beings are imitative creatures. So what do? They begin to adopt what they see, and then, you know, the image becomes a reality in a sense. But so it doesn't surprise me. But the problem, I think, though, with even beginning to call people welfare queens or to call them grant babies or grant queens or whatever the case may be, like, what is the alternative for these women? Like, what sort of work is available for these persons before you begin to condemn them for not trying, for not working hard, for not doing what they ought to be doing? Well, this is a post-Fordist, post-Keynesian economy. It's been deindustrialized. Wages have been tightened. We've gone through recession. So right now, like, where are these people going to work? I mean, you can, well, now they will pull yourself up by your bootstraps, create a business. Most small businesses fail. So what are the alternatives? We're not investing in people, but we're spending and siphoning money off to invest in prisons and places to warehouse these bodies that we deem abject, that we don't want to have to deal with, that we don't want to see. So we put them in places where we don't have to look at them, we don't have to deal with them, we don't have to talk to them, we don't have to engage them. So it's easy to dismiss a person's moral impropriety, right? And tell them, look, you need to do better, you need to work harder. But it's a deindustrialized, service-based economy, where are we going to get money? What are these people going to do? So that's the question I would ask. And in terms of reimagining blackness, it seems like you said I'm creating this dichotomy, right? It's either one way or the other, you know?
No, I don't think you're creating it. I think it's already in place. And right. Oftentimes it seems like those are the only two things that we, as African Americans, can become: either a welfare queen
or a successful, dynamic, super dynamic black
right.
person, the super black.
Right.
Yeah. Quickly, okay. Man, always quick.
We can talk about it later.
Yeah, we can talk about it later, but I just want to say, I'm just a person, ultimately, to begin with. Like, I mean, we could talk about blackness, whiteness, redness, brownness, but at the end of the day, I'm a person. I feel, I have hopes and dreams, and I just want to realize those dreams. And I hate that my possibilities are governed by this conception of what I have to be and what I need to be and what I've done and what I can't do based on what I've done and my possibilities. I just want to look at my potentiality in terms of indeterminate potentiality, because I don't know. I don't want to be governed by a concept of who I am, what I could be, what I might not be, who I have to help, who I have to uplift. I just want to be and flourish and thrive as I am. So, you know, in terms of blackness, sometimes these concepts, these whiteness, blackness concepts, they can limit us in ways we don't even see and recognize. So.
2 minutes.
Okay. This will take 15 seconds because. So I have not looked at the Eastern Bloc in reference to students going east. What I have looked at are, you know, U.S. perceptions of these students going east. So New York Times articles from the 60s in particular write about, you know, students going east as an issue, right? And so there's a emphasis from the U.S. in trying to recruit African students to the U.S. And so you have the creation of programs like ASPAU, which is the African Student Program of American universities, which recruits African students actively to the United States, right? And so it's a part of this Cold War politics, right? The U.S. is trying to maintain a certain outreach to the rest of the world. And so they create these types of programs to recruit African students as a way to maintain good relationships with their countries, right? And there's also a direct emphasis from the U.S. on the racism that these students are receiving in Russia and in China to a lesser extent, right? So they point out these examples. You know, they say there was an African student who was harassed on the street, and this is very prominent in newspapers to highlight that in the U.S. this doesn't happen, even though we know that's not true, but there is a juxtaposition that's always taking place in the papers.
Just to let you know, there's some new work that's being done on Mozambicans who were sent to the GDR. And so that I think somebody's doing a dissertation at Cambridge, but I've seen a couple of articles as well about that. So there is work going on that.
On that note, let me thank all of us, beginning with the audience and then the presenters. If you notice, what I did is to manage the time as much as possible. We had only three presenters, and the discussion was as robust as if we had about six or seven presenters on board. I'd like to thank you very much for your time, and I hope that we'll see you tomorrow. Thank you. Oh, yeah, yeah.